Welcome to episode 9 of The Infectious Myth. Today's episode is being pre-taped, so you can't call in, unfortunately, but you can always send email at david.crow, that's crow with an E, at theinfectiousmyth.com, or our website, prn.fm/shows/infectious-myth. Today, I'm very pleased to welcome Jennifer Raff, a PhD scientist who on March 25th of this year, 2014, published a blog post, and we'll post a link in the show notes, entitled Dear Parents, You Are Being Lied To. Basically, the post says that all the people out there on the internet who are saying that vaccines are dangerous are lying, and that vaccines are actually safe and effective. The post also states that diseases like measles, chickenpox, whooping cough, and the flu are serious illnesses. Jennifer, you are with us, I hope?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Well, let's give some background on you. You're a PhD anthropologist, and you study ancient American natives. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. I am actually a geneticist and an anthropologist, and I study Native American genomes and human genome evolution.
Yes, and that's why you were actually up in my city of Calgary recently at a conference or something as part of this work.
That's correct. I was presenting on my latest research up there. It was a really fun visit to a nice city.
Yes. So do you have to do field work, or as a geneticist, do you mainly do lab work?
I actually do both. I was up in the North American Arctic for a couple of years collecting samples, and but most of the time I spend in the laboratory.
Yes. And you're also a martial arts enthusiast.
Yes, I am. I have a very full plate.
Yes. And what kind of martial arts do you practice?
Well, these days I am focusing on Brazilian jiu-jitsu, but I've also done kickboxing and boxing and mixed martial arts and some more traditional martial arts as well.
So that sort of helps deal with the idea that all scientists are nerds.
Well, I'm still a nerd, but I am a nerd who is also a fighter.
Yeah. Okay. And I think you described yourself as a skeptic. And can you describe what that means?
Sure. Well, I would actually say probably a more accurate description would be scientist. I'm not part of the skeptic community in any formal way, just because mostly I don't have time between actually doing science and training. But I would say that when approaching information, using the tools of science and the tools of skepticism to evaluate claims based on their merit and based on empirical testing, it's a much better approach for getting at the truth than simply believing everything that everyone tells you, or the opposite of that, denialism, which is seeing conspiracy theories in everything.
So I mean, obviously skeptics are famous for being skeptical about the Loch Ness Monster and UFO sightings, which hopefully we can get past pretty quickly.
Yes.
But, I mean, are you skeptical of sort of mainstream scientific dogmas like global warming or HIV is the cause of AIDS, or do you accept the science in those cases?
I accept what the evidence says. And so in cases like HIV being the cause of AIDS, we have an overwhelming amount of scientific evidence, an overwhelming amount of number of studies showing that to be true. Similarly with global warming. When you look at what scientists say, for the most part, scientists are always arguing with each other. And when, on the rare occasions when they do agree on something, when the vast majority of scientists agree to something that the evidence is pointing to one conclusion, it's best to pay attention to that because it does not happen very often.
Okay, so, I mean, let's move towards vaccines. Like, the reason I found your post so interesting is because it went viral. I mean, literally, I think it was picked up by the Huffington Post, and I recently saw it. I think it's being published in other languages, and went around the world pretty quickly. So a lot of people were exposed to this message on vaccines. And would you say that there are any mainstream doctors who are skeptical of vaccines?
No, the doctors who are skeptical of vaccines, as a general rule, are not mainstream. The medical community is united in its acceptance of the fact that vaccines are safe and effective and necessary. There are a few, you'll be able to find a few physicians out there who will say that they do not agree and that they will question the evidence for vaccines, but they're incredibly rare. And if you dig pretty deep into their motivations, you'll often find that they are deriving some kind of profit from this, which is unfortunate, I think.
Right. Although I guess the mainstream doctors also derive profit from vaccinating people.
Well, not from the vaccines themselves, but from their practice, certainly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Are you one of the people who believes that vaccines should be made mandatory? Like, you're pretty strong in your viewpoints and, you know, sort of take no prisoners approach.
Yeah. Well, that's the fighter in me, right? As far as mandatory, I would say that I don't think that imposing a mandatory vaccination policy will work very well. I think that while I would like to see every child vaccinated, every child who can be vaccinated, some cannot for medical reasons. There would be a great pushback from parents who, especially, you know, in the United States, are very against any kind of imposition like that. And that's unfortunate. So I think that education is a much better way to go as far as this issue is concerned. But that's my own personal opinion. I understand that a lot of physicians would maybe disagree with me on this, and they would call for mandatory vaccinations.
Well, yeah, I was just actually listening to a radio show where they did call for mandatory vaccinations, or some people did anyway. I guess there is quite a bit of debate on that topic.
Yeah, I haven't really made up my mind on that subject. And I think I would probably defer to public policy experts on that, which I'm not. So my approach personally is to simply try and present the information as best as I can and to help educate parents in how to read scientific studies and how to understand and critically assess the information that's out there. And there's a lot, and it's very, very, right. I can understand a lot of parents' confusion.
Right.
But, you know, I would defer to the public policy experts on this question, I guess.
Okay, so let's move to measles. And measles is interesting to me because I'm probably quite a bit older than you, and I had measles in the late 50s. I was very young at the time. Maybe negative 20 or something. But I had to phone up my mother, who's in her mid-80s, and confirm with her what had actually happened. So the measles vaccine came out around 1963, and so when I had measles in the maybe as late as 1960, that was the latest possible date based on where I had it, there was no vaccine. So according to her, I had fever for a day or two, and the rash lasted about a week, so I couldn't go to school. And she stated also that she'd never heard of anyone dying from measles. So this was England in the 1950s, or in any recent history. So am I immune now that I had measles in the 50s?
You should be, yeah. I would, again, probably defer to an expert on that, which I'm not a physician. So, but it's true that immunity that's brought about by actually experiencing the disease is very strong.
Well, yes, but you said in your piece of paper, you said they say that natural infection is better than vaccination, but they're wrong.
There's a reason why I said that. That immunity brought about by both natural infection and vaccine-induced infection, well, not infection, but vaccine-induced immunity, is brought about by the same mechanism. Your body's natural immune response occurs whether you are receiving a vaccine or exposed to the disease. Now, the vaccination actually causes it's not the live pathogen. So in many cases, it's not as strong a response. And so that's why we need boosters or, you know, subsequent vaccinations as a result. But the reason that natural infection is not as good as vaccine-induced infection is because there are consequences to natural infection. We're talking about measles. I know your mother may not have known anybody to die from it, but out of every 1,000 children who are infected by measles in the United States or in the Western world, where we have good medical care, every 1 to 2 children out of the 1,000 infected are going to die. That's statistically likely. And a number of other children, you know, something like 10% of children who contract measles naturally will get ear infections, and that can lead to a loss of hearing. And they can also get pneumonia and encephalitis. So it's a very, getting these diseases is a very serious, has very serious consequences, and it's much, much better to get the vaccine where you don't have to experience these effects.
But, you know, when I went looking for this, there's been actually several outbreaks of measles in populations that have almost been totally vaccinated. For example, the Canadian Medical Journal, 1996, said that there was, they titled the paper, Outbreak of Measles in a Highly Vaccinated Secondary School Population, and they felt that it was due to the fact that people had only had one vaccine.
Mm-hmm. That's why they need a follow-up booster shot. Like I said, natural immunity, or immunity caused by naturally being infected can be, you get a stronger response. But, you know, you need to have your booster shots after you get your initial primary vaccination in order to guarantee that the vaccine-induced immunity will be just as effective.
But in the Journal of Infectious Diseases in 2013, they documented an epidemic in 2011, which is after the second booster came in. Mm-hmm. And this was a large epidemic in Quebec and Canada amongst, again, an almost entirely vaccinated population. And even the children who'd had two doses were susceptible to this epidemic. So I mean, do we need three booster shots, or, you know, two booster shots, three shots total in order to be fully protected from measles?
I mean, you need what your doctor will recommend, but in that case, perhaps it was a different strain. I'm not familiar with that study. You know, different strains of the virus are going to be different, are going to have different infectious rates, you know, and in some cases, if you're vaccinated against a different strain, that may be not as effective. So I don't know. And again, in this case, I would probably defer to an infectious disease specialist, but I would suggest that everybody follow their doctor's recommendations in this case.
Yeah, but I mean, if there's different strains of measles out there, then the story that, you know, getting the measles shot twice protects you, if it's like the flu and there's actually different strains, then
it's not quite as bad as the flu. The prevalence of the flu strain changes every year, and the measles is not as bad as that. But again, I will defer to an infectious disease specialist for this question.
Yes, I don't know if you've heard of the condition called A-gamma globulinemia. They discovered this, I think, around the time of the development of the measles vaccine. And this is children who appear normal. They get the measles normally because this was around the time when the measles vaccine wasn't really available. They become immune, but they have no trace of antibody in their system. So how do we explain that? I mean, how can you explain that if the antibodies are what protect you?
Well, A-gamma globulinemia, sorry, I have a hard time saying it. It's a very, very rare disorder, and it's genetically based. And so what this disorder is caused by is a gene defect. It's an allelic problem that blocks B lymphocyte formation.
Mm-hmm.
And B lymphocyte formation are there. It's a critical component of your immune system. So they can't make immunoglobulins, or they have very, very low levels of immunoglobulins in the bloodstream. And so what happens is they get infections all the time. And it's passed on from parent to parent, or from parent to child. And the only treatment for this is that you have to reduce the amount of and severity of infections that you can get. You know, it's a really problematic issue, but it's a very, very limited number of individuals in the population have this.
Yeah, but that's not really what was happening. Like, to quote from one of these papers from the 60s, it said, children with antibody deficiency syndromes have quite unremarkable attacks of measles with the characteristic rash and normal recovery. Furthermore, they are not unduly prone to reinfection. It therefore seems that serum antibody, at any rate in any quantity, is not required for the production of the measles rash, nor for the normal recovery, nor to prevent reinfection. So doesn't that say that natural immunity has something in it apart from antibodies that's protecting us?
So your question is, why are they still protected against measles and other?
Yeah, because they have no antibody against measles in their system.
Well, I haven't read the study myself, but I would have to defer to a physician on this question. But I think there are a number of things that we don't actually understand about this. But again, that I'm going to have to defer to a physician on this. I know that their white blood counts are normal. And so it's possible that other components of the immune system are assisting them in this and in resisting this infection.
I know there are kids who have a genetically defective immune system, and they do, you know, like there was that famous bubble boy from years
sure.
ago.
Sure, and there are children who have, my own sister, who is no longer alive, unfortunately, had a genetic disorder, and infection with any of these diseases would have killed her. So she mm-hmm. absolutely depended on herd immunity to protect her. And she was not able to be vaccinated because, you know, simply her immune system just simply couldn't handle any kind of infection. So
right, right. Now, getting to the statistics, it's pretty difficult to say that the measles vaccine reduced the death rate in North America for measles, because it had fallen from a really high level in the 1800s to virtually zero by 1963. For example, in 1963 in New England, there were, I think, 5 deaths related, you know, blamed on measles. So we're not really talking about a risk of death for measles or any significant risk, are we?
Well, we're talking about risk of infection primarily because the measles is incredibly infectious. However, the risk of death within the Western world, where we have good medical care and good nutrition, the risk of death is still 1 to 2 individuals per 1,000 infected. When you look at, but you also have to take into consideration not just death, but also other side effects of the measles infection, such as pneumonia and ear infections. In places like Africa, where there's higher rates of malnutrition and vitamin A deficiency, lethality is considerably higher, and so are some of the other unfortunate consequences of measles infection. For example, the leading cause of blindness among African children is measles infection.
And are there any cofactors to the severity of measles infection?
Well, you're going to have a worse infection if you don't have good medical care and if you don't have good nutrition. That's true.
The WHO paper that you linked to said severe measles is more likely among poorly nourished young children, especially those with insufficient vitamin A, mm-hmm. or whose immune system has been weakened by HIV, AIDS, or other diseases. Mm-hmm. So given that measles is still killing a lot of people in the poor countries and not in North America, wouldn't it be better to focus on nutrition than vaccination?
No, not at all. I mean, we don't have to only do one thing at a time. Vaccination will prevent the spread of the disease, and that's just as important as raising the general nutrition and general health of individuals. It would be ludicrous to not try and prevent a disease's spread.
Okay, so you said that doctors do admit there are side effects to vaccines, but you're implying in your paper that they're not very serious, or at least serious ones are very uncommon. So, I mean, what kind of side effects are you thinking of with vaccination?
There are some children who, well, individuals in general, who unfortunately have allergic reactions to vaccination, to the vaccines themselves, but that rate is quite low. There are a number of individuals who are already immunocompromised who, if they received the vaccine, would really suffer. And so it's definitely contraindicated for them. So that, you know, those are some of the side effects that you could have from a vaccine. Other
right,
people experience very mild things like a fever or, a little bit of pain at the injection site or redness. And those are monitored, but they're not a very serious side effect.
Yes, but don't we get to a point where a disease like measles is so rare that the number of side effects from vaccinating millions of children actually are greater than the consequences of the natural infection?
No, that's ridiculous. the side effects of vaccines are incredibly rare, and by not vaccinating children, you will lower herd immunity to the point where the disease will come back, and that's already happening in pockets of children throughout the country.
Well, yeah, I mean, we're getting measles outbreaks in fully vaccinated populations.
No, we're getting measles outbreaks also and most often in unvaccinated pockets of children, especially in the United States. I'm not sure where you're getting all of your information from, but if you go to the CDC website and look at the surveillance of children this year, all of the infections this year and last year are occurring in pockets of unvaccinated children.
Well, okay, there's a paper from the Journal of Infectious Disease in 2013. Largest measles epidemic in North America in a decade, Quebec, Canada, 2011. And this was in a fully vaccinated population, most of which had had two doses of measles. So that seems to be saying that the big measles epidemics now are in actually vaccinated people.
No, that's not true. And I would have appreciated it if you'd shared me that link so I could take a look at the paper itself before this meeting so I could talk about it. I'm not comfortable in assessing the data in a paper that I haven't actually read. But if you look at the outbreaks that are occurring this year and in 2013 throughout at least the United States and I believe also in Canada, they are occurring in pockets of unvaccinated populations. This has recently occurred here in Texas in a congregation where the preacher preached against vaccination, and all of the outbreaks occurred in children who were not vaccinated. And there's been a rush since to vaccinate everybody in that community.
Well, we had a small outbreak in Calgary this year, and in February, the Calgary Herald, our local newspaper, noted that three of the four measles victims were fully immunized, and they didn't say anything about the status of the fourth, who may have had one vaccine or none at all. It wasn't really clear. So, and everybody was very surprised about it and asking, you know, what's wrong with the vaccine? Why is it not protecting us?
Well, there's a misconception that every vaccine is 100% effective, but that it's actually more like 85% to 100% in preventing outbreaks. So in the case of the children who were vaccinated, it was likely that they fell into that range. But it's a misconception to say that the majority of outbreaks are occurring in fully vaccinated populations. Wherever you're getting your data from, it's not extrapolatable to the entire population at large.
Yeah, I didn't say that. I was just pointing out that the largest measles epidemic in a decade, according to the Journal of Infectious Disease, which is a pretty reputable publication, was in a pretty much fully vaccinated population. I'm not sure if it was 100%, but it was in the 90s anyway.
Again, I would like to see that article, and I would like to read it for myself.
I will definitely send it to you afterwards.
Thank you.
Now let's talk about some of the additives, because a lot of people criticize vaccines not so much because of the vaccine itself, but the fact that vaccines contain lots of other things. You mentioned, for example, aluminum, and you said that children consume more aluminum in natural breast milk than they do in vaccines.
Mm-hmm.
But people don't inject breast milk into their bodies, right?
That's correct.
You cannot say that milk is harmful because if you inject it, it causes disease. So really, to say that people get aluminum in breast milk doesn't say anything about the safety of injected aluminum, right?
Sure, but we've also done, not we, I'm not part of these studies, but there have also been a number of studies done looking at the rate of, the safety of the amount of aluminum in vaccines and whether or not that's a safe amount for children to be exposed to. And they've determined that all of the vaccines together for infants total looks to be about 4 milligrams of aluminum. So a milligram's 1,000th of a gram. So just to put into perspective, gram is about 1/5 of a teaspoon of water. So it's a very, very, very tiny amount. The exposure of that amount has been determined by numerous safety studies by the CDC, by the FDA, by independent laboratories funded through grants that are not from, you know.
Well, the CDC and the FDA don't do safety studies, right? They accept the data from pharmaceutical
companies.
Sure,
they companies do meta studies, though.
It.
I mean, they aggregate studies from other laboratories together to put the data in one place and make recommendations based on these aggregated data. And on the basis of this, they've determined that the amount of aluminum that's present in vaccines is a very tiny amount, and it falls well within the safety for children.
Okay, the other thing that a lot of people have, probably the additive that people are most concerned about and have said the most negative things about, is thimerosal, which is a mercury-based preservative, right?
That's right.
And I think it's 50% mercury by weight, and it's ethyl mercury.
Yes, there is a difference between ethyl mercury and methyl mercury, but I suppose we don't really need to get into the chemistry. But.
Well, I mean, it is kind of important because the FDA did an analysis, and they based the analysis on methyl mercury, and they don't really understand how the safety profile of methyl and ethyl mercury differ. I mean, they're both quite toxic, but they're not toxic in the same way. I guess they didn't have enough data on actually ethyl mercury. I mean, there was a study by HVID, which is one of the studies that claimed that thimerosal was not related to autism. But even there, they said that mercury is toxic to the kidney and to the brain at high doses.
At high doses.
I guess the argument is that it's not high enough doses in thimerosal.
Correct.
But one of the things I believe the FDA cited, when they started to remove thimerosal from vaccines in 2001, they admitted that the amount of mercury in the childhood vaccine schedule was actually above the EPA safe limits, that the amount of mercury in the body of a child would be above the EPA limits prior to 2001.
So the National Academy of Sciences studied the toxicological effects of the mercury in the vaccines, and what they concluded was that the methyl mercury that people were being exposed to was 0.1 micrograms per kilogram per day, and that fell well within the range of safety for any human exposure.
Right. I mean, one of the concerns of some parents is that you know, children will often get a bunch of vaccines all at once. So it's not really you're getting a small amount per day. You're getting a whole bunch one day and then nothing for the next year. So I think people maybe are concerned that the dose, if you go and get, you know, if you're behind on your shots and you get a whole bunch at once, you may get a pretty high dose of mercury, or would have prior to 2001.
Would have. As we said, the thimerosal has been removed from all vaccines except for, I believe, the influenza vaccine for children. And the influenza vaccine there's actually a thimerosal-free version, which parents can get if they are still concerned about it. Myself, I accept the safety regulation, the safety studies that have been done showing the amount of thimerosal being quite well within human, what is a safe range for humans. But I know that parents can be concerned about this, and so I just wanted to reassure them that their children are likely not at all being exposed to any of this unless they are giving them the influenza vaccine. That contains thimerosal.
I know that the whole autism connection is very controversial, but I did see a 2005 paper in the journal Autism, actually, that found in hair analysis of children significantly higher concentrations of lead, mercury, and uranium, which, of course, doesn't say where those came from.
Precisely.
But it does seem to be saying that heavy metals are are related to these.
But those are not in the vaccines. And when thimerosal was removed from all childhood vaccinations, if that was the cause of autism, the autism rate should have declined, and it did quite the opposite.
Yes. Yeah, I agree. That's pretty strong evidence that it can't be the thimerosal that is the sole cause of autism.
Well, the parents are, I mean, the people who are involved, parents are concerned, and I totally understand why they would be, because if you do not understand, you know, the scientific studies out there and you don't understand how to read them, I think it could be quite concerning for them. And that's why I'm trying my best to help them evaluate this evidence. But the people who are claiming a link between autism and vaccines are moving the goalposts constantly. So first they said it was the thimerosal in the vaccines, but that's been shown not to be the case. So then they say, oh, it must be the aluminum. But again, that also has been debunked. So then they say, well, it's the effect of so many vaccines at once. And safety studies have shown that that's not the case either. So now they're reduced to saying, you know, vague things like toxins, or the argument just continues. Or they will continue with the argument saying that everybody who is doing these studies must be in the pay of Big Pharma, and there must be some large conspiracy going on, which is why everybody's coming up with these scientific studies to disprove their theories. And it's a bit of a problem. I think that if parents sat down and looked at the evidence, they would see that these arguments are spurious. And it's really unfortunate that they're being given so much credence.
I just wanted to point out that 2005 paper on autism found that the higher concentrations of metals that were associated with autism included mercury, which is in thimerosal. Right.
Say, what did you say again? I'm sorry.
The children with autism had significantly P less than 0.001 higher in hair concentrations of lead, mercury, and uranium. And mercury is obviously the metal in thimerosal, right?
I still don't understand your point. And I, again, wish you had sent me that paper to read before you brought it up on the show.
Well, I'm just pointing out that they found a connection between those three heavy metals. They looked at many metals, and the only three that they found significantly correlated with autism were lead, mercury, and uranium. And, I mean, I think lead and mercury are well known as neurotoxins, like the Mad Hatter in Alice in Wonderland was a hatter, and they used mercury to preserve, obviously, high concentrations of mercury to make their hats. So we know that in high concentrations it's toxic. I guess the question is, where is the lead, mercury, and uranium coming from?
That would be a question for somebody who's doing those kinds of, you know, epidemiological studies. It's not likely to be coming from the vaccines, but I think that, you know, just showing that those high concentrations are present doesn't say anything about where they're coming from, unfortunately. It would be nice to know.
But you know, would you say that a child, I mean, most children have not been measured for mercury, but if a child had an excess burden, I mean, let's say they ate a lot of fish or something which has mercury, would you think that avoiding thimerosal was wise if your body burden of mercury was already high?
That would be a question for a physician, and I'm not a physician, but my suggestion is that you're getting plenty of mercury and aluminum exposure from the foods you eat. And you're eating quite a bit more of it than you would be getting from a vaccine. And yes, that's different than being injected, but you're still, there's humongous concentrations of these, of at least aluminum in, not only in breast milk, but also in formula. And you're ingesting a considerably larger quantity of that over the lifespan of your childhood than you would be from the small amount you're getting in vaccines.
Yeah, but again, you can't really compare what you're ingesting with what you're injecting, right? I mean, stuff that goes straight into your body.
I don't know about that, because how much are you really, how much is a child ingesting over the course of his or her childhood in, I mean, it's significantly higher quantities in either breast milk or in formula. I mean, much higher quantities.
Right, but how much gets into, I mean, a lot of what we eat is, I mean, it's highly processed, right? So it doesn't go into our bloodstream in anywhere near the same quantity. I mean, if you inject something into the body, 100% goes in, but if you
Yeah, but you're not injecting it into the bloodstream.
It's a small,
you're injecting it into muscle tissue where it's broken down.
Well, mercury can't really be broken down, right? Mercury is an element, so
sure, but it's removed from the body in the same way that anything else is. I mean, I guess I don't understand your point here.
Yeah. Okay, so there was a 2003 paper in Experimental Biology and Medicine that looked at the Vaccine Adverse Events Reporting System, which is, I guess, the U.S. government's database of vaccine adverse reactions. And they claimed a statistical increase in the incidence rate of autism between the thimerosal-containing diphtheria, tetanus, and acellular pertussis, the DTaP vaccine, versus the thimerosal-free vaccine. So, I mean, isn't there still some evidence out there that autism is associated with vaccination?
Okay, first of all, this is yet another study that you are bringing up that you have not given me the opportunity to read or comment on. So I would have appreciated you giving me a list of the papers you wanted to talk about before we talk about them, so I could have read it. Second of all, the vaccine adverse that the vaccine courts themselves do not have any kind of standard that looks at, they simply look at all reported effects. They do not look at, they do not screen it for what is likely to be a cause. So anything that is reported after a vaccine is included in that. There's no correlation, there's no causation studies done to determine whether or not one effect was caused by the vaccine itself. So, well, you know, you have to be very, very careful when you're evaluating data from these just blanket reporting situations.
Well, yes. I mean, obviously, it's estimated that a very small percentage of adverse reactions are ever reported because whether it's drugs or vaccines, they're often not recognized. And it often relies on the doctor to report them, which is kind of a conflict of interest because the doctor's prescribed you something and they have to report that there was a problem, which they may worry about, you know, lawsuits and things like that, especially in the United States. But this was not an analysis of what the court decided. It was an analysis of what went into the database. And, I mean, it does seem worrisome that they would find a risk ratio of autism six times higher with a thimerosal-containing vaccine versus the same vaccine not thimerosal-containing.
If the information that is being used to do this analysis is faulty, if it's simply not, you know, carefully controlled studies like are done for research, then you cannot rely upon the analyses of these.
So, I mean, is the vaccine adverse events reporting system totally useless? Like,
how... No, I don't think it is useless. I think it's useful for monitoring potential effects, but you can't do scientific studies on these reports.
Well, I'm not... Explain that to me. So this guy looked at, or this group of researchers looked at the statistics in the database. They looked at accounts of cases of various conditions after certain vaccines, which may or may not be related to vaccines, and, you know, obviously not all are reported. But if the purpose of the database is to monitor, and these people were monitoring what was happening, like, what's wrong with their analysis?
You know, I have to say that I think it's incredibly disingenuous of you to be asking me to comment on studies that I haven't read and that you haven't brought to me to discuss. You didn't say that we were going to talk about this in advance, and...
Well, you wrote a paper saying, you know, to the world that you knew that vaccines were safe, and yet you seem to have avoided talking about any studies that actually showed that there were any problems.
Like, that's not true. We talked about plenty of them. We discussed plenty of them in the comments. This, the article that I wrote was, you know, I feel that you're trying to do a hit piece on me right now because you're bringing up quite a bit of information that we didn't agree that we were going to be discussing in advance. I cannot comment on scientific articles that I haven't read. And if you're bringing up something
many,
that I haven't read.
Many scientists, and I have never told them ahead of time what my sources of data are. If I interview an expert on a particular subject, I expect that they know the literature. And if somebody writes a paper or, you know, an article saying that vaccines are safe, I assume that they've reviewed both sides of the argument.
Sure, I have. But this specific paper you're asking me to comment on, and as well as a number of others that you brought up, you know, I don't have them in front of me. You haven't asked me to read them to discuss
these.
That seems a bit disingenuous on your part.
On autism and vaccines, and I found these papers very easily. So I assumed that you would have looked particularly hard at all the papers that showed some connection between autism and vaccines so that you could
absolutely
debunk them instead of avoiding them.
No, absolutely. I've read them, and I've also read the literature showing again and again that they are safe, that every major study has shown that there is no connection between autism and vaccines.
Well, okay, so you've read all these studies, but not the ones that I found quite easily saying that there may be a connection. So I'm a little confused about the fact that you actually analyzed both sides of the argument, because all the papers you cited were papers claiming that vaccines were safe and effective. And most of them were not even scientific. Like, the first papers that you cited were Forbes, the Weather Channel, the World Health Organization, and then three from the CDC before you got to a scientific paper. And most of your scientific papers were actually review papers. They were not actual scientific
studies.
So
you don't believe that the species is scientific?
Well, clearly.
Your review papers are not, you don't recognize the review papers as part of the scientific literature?
No, they're not peer-reviewed, right? They're anonymous authors. There's no opportunity for people to comment on CDC or WHO pronouncements. They put up a fact sheet. How do you get the World Health Organization to change a fact sheet?
You do a scientific, a carefully controlled scientific study that demonstrates such a link. You repeat it in a large enough population with large enough sample size. And, you know, that calls people's attention to it. And the WHO then includes that in their analyses. I'm very concerned about your motives here. What exactly are you trying to achieve by...
I'm trying to have a discussion about the very bold statements that you made, that there's nothing that parents should worry about.
I never said that at all.
I did a little bit of research, and I discovered things that appear to be very contradictory to what you were saying. And I found that the whole issue was a lot grayer than you were saying.
The research that you've done have been familiar with, and I would like to check their...
Well, I will definitely send you all of the papers that I have reviewed.
And it'd be very nice if you had done that before, so I could have done such a...
Well, as I said, whenever I've interviewed people before, I've just assumed that they're familiar with the literature in the area that they claim some expertise in. And it didn't take me, I didn't have to look very hard to find...
Yes, and I am familiar with the literature, but it would have been nice...
I'm afraid, apart from all of the other problems, that you're breaking up quite a bit on Skype. I don't know if there's anything can be done about that. I don't want to lose your comments. Can you hear me? And if PRN's on the line, can you hear her without...
Hello, is that better?
It's still breaking up a little bit, which is really unfortunate.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I'll try and move to a different location. Is that better? All right, great.
Yes. Okay, so if we can try to continue.
Sure.
You talked about, I don't know if you talked explicitly about Andrew Wakefield, but he's probably the most famous case of a scientist who claimed to find some negative information about vaccines. But I mean, are you familiar with what Wakefield actually claimed?
Yeah, Wakefield claimed to have found an association between the MMR vaccine and both bowel disorders and also autism.
Yeah.
Or what he called regressive autism, excuse me.
Right, right. And there was an article published in The Lancet that claimed to debunk this, claimed that the research was fraudulent, basically. But... I mean, were you aware that that article was written by a journalist and not by a scientist?
The article was not actually published in The Lancet. It was an investigation that was published an investigation by a journalist for both the Sunday Times of London, Channel 4 Network, and the British Medical Journal.
The British Medical Journal, you're right, It was not The Lancet. But that seems kind of strange, doesn't it, that a counter study would be done by a journalist and not by a scientific analysis?
No, actually, in this case, the counter study were the subsequent research studies that have been done attempting to replicate Wakefield's results, and attempting and failing. What the study that was done by the journalist was an investigative report. So he wasn't doing a scientific study. He was going back and interviewing the families of the children who were used as subjects in Wakefield's study. He was also digging into Wakefield's past and discovering that Wakefield was paid money in order to come at this predetermined result, which was a serious conflict of interest that Wakefield never disclosed. And what he found in the course of his investigation was that the children used in the study, many of them already had autism prior to the start of the study and other symptoms that Wakefield described. The parents of the children said that if Wakefield had used their children in the study when they discovered they were part of it, they said that he fabricated his results. And I'm sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead, continue.
Oh, no. One of the fathers of the children said, if my son is this patient, the Lancet article is an outright fabrication, Wakefield's article. Wakefield faked a lot of the data that was included in there. His co-authors removed their names from his study. And after the investigation by the Lancet itself into the research, they retracted the article.
Actually, I think the article was published without Wakefield's name in another journal.
Really? Which one was that?
Yeah. I should have done that research ahead of time, but I'm going to look into that. I mean, Wakefield did not claim, his claim was actually pretty minor. He found an association between inflammation of the large intestine with autism, which doesn't say anything about what caused it. And then he said that these symptoms had been reported after vaccination with MMR. So I don't think he was directly saying...
No, he made that case directly. He published actually a couple of papers on the subject. I'm not sure if you're referring to the Lancet one. But once he published the Lancet article, he then went and had a press press conference in which he explicitly said that this was the case. And he had a number of press conferences and discussing in the media that the MMR vaccine was causing this. So, and he has stuck by that for the most part. Now he's starting to retract some of what he said and trying to change the record a bit. But, his comments are on record as saying this.
Okay, well, let's move on to another popular vaccine. I know you're from Texas, right?
And, yes.
And your governor, Rick Perry, tried to make the HPV vaccine mandatory in Texas a little while ago. I don't know if you...
Yeah, I was familiar with that. That was before I moved here, but yeah.
Yes, yeah. Which seemed a little strange since he was right-wing, libertarian, all this kind of stuff. But I guess it didn't happen. But, I mean, what's your feeling about the HPV vaccine and cervical cancer?
I wish it had been around sooner because the HPV vaccine is a very great preventative measure against cervical cancer.
The Nobel Prize Committee said that it will be decades before we know whether it will be effective at reducing the risk of cancer.
Well, yes, we have to do post-surveillance studies quite a bit, but all of the research that's done up until now has proven that the risk is decreased significantly. Which report are you referring to?
The Nobel Prize Committee in 2008, they gave the Nobel Prize to Zurhausen, who was the discoverer of HPV. And when the Nobel Prize is given out, they write a citation explaining why they chose to give the prize to this particular person. And in that, they said that it would be decades before we know if the vaccine that was derived from Zurhausen's work on HPV will actually reduce the risk of cervical cancer.
Sure, because one has to take into account, will the vaccine be used widely or will it not be used at all? So the risk of cervical cancer is coupled to the effects of the vaccine. If nobody's going to be vaccinating people, then I think that, it will not be able to tell that.
But cervical cancer was not an outcome measured in the trials of the vaccine, so it's purely hypothetical, isn't it?
Cancer not caused by HPV?
I guess...
Is that what you're claiming?
I'm kind of neutral on that.
Really sound particularly neutral to me.
Well, I'm just citing what the Nobel Prize Committee said. I mean, I don't think you can state that if you reduce the risk of pathological signs that are associated with cancer, then in most people do not lead to cancer, that by reducing those pathological signs that you will reduce the risk of cancer. That seems
There are some HPV strains that lead to most HPV-related cancers, and it has been demonstrated clinically and also in the research literature that the vaccine reduces those HPV strains. The vaccine increases your chance of not getting those HPV strains. So if you're arguing that, therefore, we're not, I'm not really sure what your logic
is. Okay, well, let me quote directly from the Nobel citation. Discoveries whether these vaccines, that's the HPV vaccine, are effective in preventing not only against cervical lesions, but also cervical cancer and death, must await the collection of epidemiological data during the coming decades.
Yes, that's epidemiological data. We have to see whether or not the vaccines are used widely, how, and this is common post-vaccination surveillance programs that have to be done.
But, I mean, we could find in 20 years that there has been no reduction in death from cervical cancer, which in the United States is a pretty rare cancer, actually.
So first of all, are you saying that because it's rare that we should not be taking steps to prevent it?
Well, no.
What is the rate of cervical cancer in the United States? Do you know?
It's a few hundred a year.
What percentage of people get HPV?
The number of people with HPV is vastly greater than the number of people with cancer, right?
Do you know which strains cause HPV?
Well, according to the Nobel Prize Committee, HPV 16 is associated with the largest number of cancers, and then HPV 18.
Okay, so what else does the Nobel Prize Committee say about the vaccine's efficacy against getting that strain?
Well, it says that it's effective in reducing cervical lesions, but...
So those lesions don't lead to cancer?
Not in most cases. But
because we have treatment for them, but in some cases the lesions are not caught in time, and so they do develop into cancer. I mean, it's the same with, you know, cancerous masses anywhere in the body. If you catch it in time, you have a greater chance of preventing it from developing into cancer. But that is not 100%, and there are many places where these lesions are not detected or there is not the opportunity to prevent them. They don't have the medical expertise or equipment or facilities to prevent them from developing into cancer. So are you saying that we should therefore not use the vaccine?
Well, I don't think anybody treats cervical lesions that are precancerous, do they?
They do. Your information is not accurate.
What treatments? I mean, I don't know about this. What treatments do they use for cervical lesions that are not cancerous?
They're precancerous, and what is done generally, it's almost, I'm trying to remember the name of the specific treatment. I'd have to Google it. I'm sorry. I'm not a, but anyway, it's actually, you go and it's almost like cautery. You have to remove the precancerous lesions and study them, and you have to prevent them from growing. I'm not sure where you're getting the information that you don't treat those. Those are treated as quickly as possible. That's why women have pap smears every year to determine whether or not they have them.
Well, I guess, not being a woman, I haven't been through that, but my understanding was the pap smear said whether you had cancer or not, and if you had cancer, you got treated.
No, that's not correct. The pap smears say whether or not you have the virus. The pap smears also determine whether or not you have these precancerous lesions and whether or not they should be treated.
Okay, what would you say 20 years from now if a large number of women have been vaccinated and there's been no reduction in the death rate?
Well, I would say we need better vaccines and we need better treatment against cervical cancer. But, you know, this Nobel Prize Committee report does not carry the same weight as the thousands and thousands of primary research studies that have been done showing that this vaccine is effective. The Nobel Prize Research Committee report is simply saying that we need to monitor and see what happens after these in populations that these vaccines are introduced to. Are they going to be continually being vaccinated? Is the vaccination rate going to stay high? And then what happens to the cancer rate as a result? That's normal post-vaccination surveillance. I'm not sure why you're cherry-picking this particular sentence or two to use it as evidence that the HPV vaccine shouldn't be used. That's crazy.
Well, I mean, you've brought up an interesting point. I mean, I guess what you're saying is the effectiveness of a vaccine is composed of two things. First of all, the inherent effectiveness. You know, does it actually work? And then secondly, is it used? So, is the Nobel Prize Committee saying that we know the vaccines are effective if used, but we're not sure people have used them? Or are they saying we don't actually know if they will reduce the risk of cancer just because they were only shown to reduce the risk of cervical lesions?
Really not understanding how cervical cancer works. The cervical lesions develop into cancer. And again, I'm not going to comment on the specifics of the Nobel Committee report because I haven't read it, because you did not say, oh, we're going to be discussing this.
I would like to correct something I said earlier. The number of women in the United States dying from cervical cancer in the last year that the CDC has here was 3,939. So it's higher than I said. But that number has been going down. In the past 40 years, this is what the CDC says, the number of cases of cervical cancer and the number of deaths from cervical cancer has decreased significantly. So in 20 years from now, if the number of cases of cervical cancer is 2,000, how would we know that the vaccine had caused that reduction and it wasn't the trends that are already underway?
Well, they account for this. They will look at the percentage of, they will statistically analyze the percentage of people getting vaccinated and the reduction in the persistence of that virus within the community. These are tested statistically, and it's done post, in retrospect. A retrospective study will be done to do this.
Right. Now,
I'm also curious, why are you citing the CDC if you seem not to trust their information on some things?
I'm just saying it's not a scientific organization, but they are a statistical
organization.
It is
very much a scientific organization.
Disagree on that. The reason why I'm citing this is because I think they're pretty good at collecting statistics.
They're good at collecting statistics, but not analyzing scientific data?
They are, they have a built-in bias. They are very much in favor of vaccination, and so I wouldn't expect...
Because the evidence supports vaccination, and the same tools that they are using to make that determination are the same tools that they're using to collect statistics on public health. So why do you accept one but not the other?
Well, somebody discovered, it was published, I think, in Harper's Magazine, a PowerPoint on the flu
vaccine.
Harper's
Magazine?
There was a PowerPoint from the CDC, and it was published as part of an article, I believe, in Harper's Magazine, and it showed that the CDC had an internal meeting, and they were talking about how to increase the risk of fear about the influenza, because without fear, they couldn't get the vaccination rates up. To me, that's
so not you're mentioning some PowerPoint that somebody published in Harper Magazine as evidence that the CDC is not a scientific organization. You're really, really coming up with some interesting conspiracies here.
Well, I'll send you a link to the article.
I would appreciate that, yes. And again, it would have been nice, things that you bring up in here would be nice to have seen these prior to, so I can evaluate them for myself.
It's possible that the guy who wrote the article just made this up, but I don't think Harper's would have published it without fact checking. So I assume.
That's not a scientific journal, and I don't know. I'm very much questioning your citation of this.
Okay, I guess all I'm saying is that the CDC may have convinced itself on scientific basis that vaccination was good, but they now see their role as promoting vaccination, and that's not really compatible with skeptical analysis of the science.
Would you say the same thing about the American Medical Association or the American Academy of Pediatrics or the World Health Organization? Are we all in some giant global conspiracy here?
Well, no, but the American Medical Association is a trade association for doctors, for a certain type of doctor, so obviously they're going to be biased towards the treatment that those doctors provide. The AMA is very opposed to treatment.
What about the
cancer?
National Academy of Sciences? They are not they are not medical doctors. That's the most eminent, respectable scientists around. Are you saying that they're also wrong?
And that they're also part
of this conspiracy?
I
you're
don't
really reaching for straws here. I'm just not
I'm
sure what you're...
I'm trying to respond to your comments. I was merely pointing out that the CDC was caught through this PowerPoint
This is not a credible source. You must cite this. A PowerPoint? Come on.
Well, I don't care how the CDC, you know, if the CDC has an internal meeting that says that we need to increase the fear among the population.
We don't even know that occurred. I mean, come on, where's the source? Where are you getting this from?
It was an article in Harper's Magazine, and although you say it's not a scientific journal, and I agree with you, mainstream magazines like Harper's or the other big ones have to do fact-checking or their credibility will be destroyed. I mean, if it was found that this guy had faked, and I believe this guy was a medical student at a big university on the East Coast, so he wasn't, you know, just...
A medical student is not a CDC doctor. There's a big difference there.
Okay.
So, listen, I mean, we can talk about this hypothetically all we want, but, you know...
I will send you some links, because the music tells me that we've come to the end of another episode, but I really appreciate you tussling with me over the issue of vaccines, and thank you so much for being with me today.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.